Hello friends, a very good day to all. I am Dr. Vishal Sood, teacher educator. In the previous lesson, we have learned about the achievement test, what are the functions of an achievement test, how an achievement test helps the teacher in improving learning of among the students, and how the achievement test can help the teacher in improving his or her teaching. In today's lesson, we are going to discuss about the achievement and unit test. What are its features, advantages, and steps of construction of achievement test and the unit test? So, our today's discussion will focus on these main points. First, we will discuss about characteristics of a good achievement test. What are the characteristics? What are the qualities of a good achievement test? What do we mean by the concept? What are the features and what are the advantages of the unit test that will be taken subsequently? And then we will discuss about the steps of constructing achievement test. Then in the last, a part of that construction of achievement test, how a table of specification is prepared or how a blueprint of achievement test is prepared, we will deliberate on that. So the main framework of today's discussion will remain on these main points. So first of all, we will discuss about the characteristics of a good achievement test. As you can see on the screen, that the first and foremost characteristic of a good achievement test is that it should serve the intended purpose of learning the subject, unit, or topic. That means any test which is made by you, which is developed by you, must serve the purpose for which it is meant. If you are preparing a test in mathematics or in algebra or in English, then why you have prepared that test? Whether to assess the knowledge and understanding or some other purpose? So any good test must serve the intended purpose of learning. That means from a test, it should be clear to the teacher that what the students have learned and what students have not learned. Then the test is said to be a good one if there is no ambiguity in the test items and are very clear for each student. That means the question should be made very clear, very precise, technically very accurate, and they should be very clear, and clear meaning should be imparted through every question to each student. Then a test is said to be good if it can be scored without any biases. That means there should be objectivity in any achievement test, and the results can be easily and meaningfully explained or interpreted to the students and their parents. That means why we conduct achievement tests, we carry out achievement tests so that the students' learning could be assessed, so that the results of those tests could be explained to the students, and the results of the student on that particular achievement test could be explained to the parents. So the test should be a good one if it is scored very easily without any bias, there should be objectivity in it, and it should be easily interpretable. And the last characteristic of any good achievement test is that it should be reliable one. That means anybody who is going through the marks obtained an achievement test must rely on, or the marks obtained by the student on a test must be reliable. We can rely on those marks that that test is giving accurate information, authentic information, and valid information about the performance, about the characteristics, or about the achievement of the students. So these are the main characteristics of any good achievement test. Now, unit test. You must have learned about, or you must have heard about, unit test. What do we mean by unit? A unit consists of interlinked concepts. Through the concepts, though the concepts within different units are related to each other, yet for convenience, every unit is regarded as independent. That means a unit has many smaller concepts, and these smaller concepts are interlinked to each other. So a small test which is prepared on certain smaller number of concepts, that is known as a unit test. The unit test is planned considering the amount of content coverage and the expected learning outcomes and time available for it. That means a unit test depends on how much content matter is to be covered in that. What are the expected learning outcomes? That means what learning objectives you have set while teaching in the class, and how much time is available with you as a teacher to administer that test. Keeping all these three things into consideration, the amount of the content matter, the learning objectives, and the time available with you, on the basis of these three things, unit test is prepared. The unit test is a formative type of assessment. That means a unit test is used to identify the learning difficulties among the students, to provide them remedial measures, and to improve learning among them. So unit test is a very small test which is based on smaller number of concepts and is used to identify the weaknesses, the learning difficulties, and strengths of the students so as to enhance learning among them. Now, what are the features of unit test? You can see on the screen, a unit test usually covers limited competencies and is conducted in a lesser time in comparison to other summative tests. That means it is based on limited number, smaller number of competencies or smaller, shorter content, and conducted in a smaller time as compared to summative tests. Summative tests, which are conducted at the end of the session or at the end of the course, they are more time consuming. That means more time is required for them to be completed. Then the another feature of unit test is, if the study units are found to be too small, suppose you are developing a unit test and the units are very small, then you can prepare or develop a unit test after completion of 2 or 3 units. That means you can club up or compile smaller number of concepts and then you can develop a unit test. If one unit test covering those 2 or 3 units may be conducted, that means a unit test may comprise of 2 or 3 units. That means the smaller number of concepts, they are compiled together, they are taken together, and a single unit test may be developed by you to assess the knowledge, the understanding, the application abilities of the students. Other features of unit test are that similarly, if the bigger unit is there, you can break up that unit into smaller units. That means a unit, if you see that this unit is a bigger one, having larger number of concepts or more number of concepts, then you can break that larger unit into smaller units. That means you can divide those concepts into small groups, and on the basis of those small groups, you can develop smaller unit tests. A unit test is useful in assessing more competencies if administered frequently. That means unit test should be administered frequently, regularly, on a continual basis, and it will be more useful in assessing the competencies among the children. The maximum marks for a unit test is decided by the teacher. That means how much marks are to be allotted to a particular unit test, it is up to the teacher, it is to be decided by the teacher, keeping into consideration what is the length of the unit test, how many concepts are to be covered in that unit test. So these are the features of unit test. Now, what are the advantages of unit test? We will discuss about those advantages. The unit test provides feedback which helps the students in recognizing their learning difficulties. That means unit tests are just like formative assessments which helps the students in identifying their learning difficulties, and on the basis of those learning difficulties, the remedial measures can be designed, and accordingly, the corrective measures or the feedback can be provided to the students. These unit tests also help the teacher to modify his or her teaching methodology and plan for alternate learning experiences for the students who have learning difficulties. That means on the basis of unit test results, a teacher can improve his or her teaching strategies. He can come to know which type of teaching methodology has succeeded in achieving its objectives and which teaching method has failed in enhancing the achievement among the students. It can tell us about what type of instructional material may prove to be more useful, may prove to be more beneficial in enhancing learning among the students. And on the basis of this, you as a teacher can improve upon your teaching methodologies, upon instructional material, and accordingly you can design alternate learning experiences for the students who faced difficulty during the teaching learning process. The other advantage of unit test is that you have seen that normally the unit tests are conducted in one period of 30 to 40 minutes. These are the small tests. So it does not affect the other activities of the class or the school in the conduct of the unit test. That means if you are going to conduct unit test, it will not have any adverse influence on school functioning or class functioning, because these units are very small that can be completed within a duration of 30 to 40 minutes. They cover smaller number of concepts. So it will not affect adversely the school functioning or the classroom functioning. You can easily conduct the unit test in the class. Then, marks scored on the unit test are less important than the diagnosis of the strengths and weaknesses of the students. That means in unit tests, the diagnosis of the strengths and the difficulties of the students or weaknesses of the students are given more preference, are given more weightage. They are to be identified through these unit tests, and the marks obtained by the students are not given much importance in case of unit tests. The marks carry more weightage, more preference in case of the summative tests. But unit tests are formative assessments, so the diagnosis of student strengths and their learning difficulties carry much weightage, carry much preference. Now, the unit tests, because these are conducted in an informal environment, it reduces the stress of examination among the students. That means such tests are conducted in a very informal, in a very friendly manner, or to improve the learning among the students. So it reduces the examination stress, the stress which is related to the examination or the test anxiety among the students. So this is also an advantage of unit tests. Now, what are the steps of constructing an achievement test or a unit test? You can see on the screen, there are four major steps of construction of any achievement test or a unit test. Unit test is also an achievement test based on smaller number of concepts. The first step is planning for the test. After planning, writing the test items. The test items are written, the questions are written for that test. Then the third step comes assembling and editing the test items. The items, the questions are assembled, the editing is done, and the last step is specifying the scoring procedure, how that test will be scored, how the items will be scored. It will be decided by the teacher. So these are the four steps: planning, writing of the questions, assembling and editing the items, and specifying the scoring procedure. Now, we will deliberate on these steps one by one. First of all, planning the achievement test. A good test requires adequate and extensive planning. A teacher must be well versed how to plan for a test. The planning process gives answer to the following questions, such as, what does the teacher want to do? That means, why the teacher want to use a test? Why you are taking the test of the student? This answer has to be given by you at the time of planning for that particular test. Why you are going to take the test? Why you are developing that test? If it is to be used for assessing the knowledge or understanding, if it is to be used for assessing the aptitude of the student, what will be the main purpose? It must be clear to the teacher why he is going to develop that test. Then, why is the test being administered? That means whether you are going to judge the mastery of the student on certain skills and knowledge, or whether you are going to rank the students on the basis of achievement, whether the test will be meant for ranking or grading. This must be clear to the teacher while developing or while planning for the test. Or whether you are going to develop that test for diagnosing the learning difficulties of student. That means, will it be a diagnostic test? So the purpose of the test must be clear to the student, the teacher, so that the appropriate test, an authentic, a valid test, a good achievement test could be developed. Then you have to answer at the time of planning that what are to be tested. That means what content is to be covered, what objectives are to be covered. Those objectives need to be defined at the stage of planning. What are the learning objectives you have made during teaching learning process? What content you have covered? What you have taught in the class? All these things are needed to be kept into consideration while planning for the test. These answers are to be given by you during the planning stage. Then the next step comes in construction of a test, that is writing the items for the test. For writing the test items, the teacher has to prepare a table of specification, which is sometimes also called as a blueprint. That is a two-way arrangement of course content and course objectives. This table of specification or blueprint of the test is a two-way arrangement of course content and course objective, which we will see in the coming slides. That how a table of specification or blueprint is prepared while planning for the test or while writing items of the test. So a blueprint of the test or a table of specification, it can be prepared in two ways. That we will see now how the table of specification or a blueprint can be prepared. Learners, as you know, an architect or an engineer, when plan for construction of a building, he prepares the blueprint or map of the building. Similarly, in our teaching learning process, when the test is to be prepared, we have to prepare first the blueprint of that test, which is known as table of specification or the blueprint. Now, how this blueprint or table of specification can be prepared? There are two different styles. Let us see those two different styles. The first one is this. You can see on the screen that row-wise, we have the content matter. Suppose you are teaching on a topic like the properties of oxygen or properties of water. Then you divide that content matter into smaller concepts. We have already said that unit test is a small test based on smaller number of concepts. Now, you are preparing a test on the properties of water or properties of oxygen or this. So, physical properties, chemical properties of water or chemical properties of carbon dioxide, preparation of carbon dioxide, uses of carbon dioxide. We divided this topic into these four smaller contents or concepts. And in the columns, you can see on the screen, there are learning objectives, knowledge, understanding, application, skill. So that means in the table, you can see that where the physical properties and knowledge cell meets, there we have written 8. That means on the physical properties of carbon dioxide, 8 items or 8 questions will be prepared, which will be related to the knowledge, or through which those items, through those 8 questions, the knowledge of the students will be assessed, and that knowledge will be based on physical properties of carbon dioxide. Similarly, you can see there are 9 questions for assessing the understanding of the students regarding the chemical properties of carbon dioxide. So this is a table of specification showing the distribution of the content matter along the learning objectives, that how the questions will be distributed, how many questions will be there for assessing the understanding, how many questions will be there for assessing the application ability of the students, and those application abilities will how be related to the content matter. This you can see on the screen. Now you can see on the screen where the preparation is there, preparation of carbon dioxide in laboratory. Now this is not related to knowledge, this has been dealt with the skill part. So 6 questions have been kept for the preparation part of the content matter, and that deals with the skill objectives. That means we wish to assess the skills of the students in preparing carbon dioxide in the laboratory. So this is one style of preparing the table of specification or blueprint of a test. Whenever you will prepare a test, an achievement test or a unit test, try to prepare a table like this, along which where the content matter is in, can be in the rows, the learning objectives or expected learning outcomes, or which domain will be assessed, that will be along the columns. So this is the one way of preparing the blueprint of an achievement test. Then another blueprint, another style of preparing the blueprint of a unit test or achievement test, you can see on the screen. This is on the one side, in the rows, we have the content matter, physical properties, chemical properties, preparation, use, and on in the columns, you can see objective type items, very short answer type items, short answer type questions, essay type questions. So you can see there are 6 questions, objective type questions, which will deal with physical properties of carbon dioxide. Similarly, 6 questions, very short answer type related to physical properties. 6 questions, short answer type related to physical properties of carbon dioxide. 2 essay type questions will be there in the test, which will be related to physical properties of carbon dioxide. In this manner, you will decide how many questions will be there for a particular concept in your test, and what type of questions will be those, whether they will be objective type questions or they will be very short answer type or long answer type questions. It is to be decided by you, keeping into consideration your learning objectives, the purpose of your test, why you are taking that test. Keeping all these things into consideration, you can prepare a blueprint, a framework of your unit test or achievement test. This will help you in framing the items, framing the questions. You will be very clear on the basis of this blueprint that such type of items or such number of items has to be prepared on this topic, on this concept. So these are the 2 styles of the preparing the blueprint of the unit test, and it is very helpful for a teacher at the time of preparing a unit test or a achievement test. I hope you have you are clear now about the blueprint or table of specification of the test. Now, third step comes in construction of a unit test or an achievement test is editing of test items and specifying the scoring procedure. Third and fourth step. Now you have prepared a table of specification or blueprint, the test items are written. You start writing the questions. You start preparing the questions. If 10 multiple choice questions or objective type items are to be written, you start writing those questions. Then after the test questions or items are written, they are edited by reviewing each item on the basis of its appropriateness, usefulness, and clarity and the language. That means the test items are evaluated in terms of its linguistic clarity, in terms of its technical clarity, in terms of its appropriateness. All these things are taken into consideration, and the test questions are edited. If the language is okay, Is the language understandable by the students? Are the students able to understand such type of language or not? Whether the options given in a multiple choice question are appropriate, are distracting the child from the right response. All these things are taken into consideration, and accordingly, the addition or the reviewing of the test items are done. And for this, you can have a second thought on that test, or you can take or seek the help of your colleagues, your teachers, who can judge your test, whether it has been developed in an appropriate manner, in an accurate manner or not. So this is the editing or reviewing of the test item. This is to improve the accuracy, the authenticity, the validity of the test. The addition and reviewing is done to improve the validity of the test. Then, the next step after editing or reviewing the test items, the next step is to prepare a scoring process or scoring procedure. You specify the scoring procedure, or you prepare a scoring key along with the questions through which a teacher can be more clear how to score the questions, how to award marks to the students, how to grade them. This will be clear to the teacher if a scoring key will be prepared by you, how to assign the marks, how to assign the grade, or how to follow the marking procedure. So this is the last step, that is preparing the scoring process, preparing or constructing an achievement test or unit test. In any subject, you can follow these simple steps to construct an achievement test. So learners, what we discussed in today's lesson, that is, first of all, we discussed about the characteristics of good achievement test. What are the qualities, what are the features of a good achievement test? Then we discussed about the unit test, what we mean by unit test, what are its features, and what are the advantages of a unit test for a teacher as well as to the students. Then we discussed in detail about the steps of constructing an achievement test. There are four steps of constructing. First, we plan for the test, then the test items are written, then the editing and reviewing of those items is done, and finally we prepare a scoring procedure or specify a scoring procedure. Now, while preparing or constructing an achievement test, we came to know how a table of specification or blueprint of the achievement test can be prepared. And we discussed about the two styles of preparing blueprint or table of specification while preparing any achievement test or unit test in any subject. So this was all about today's lesson. I hope, learners, you have understood all these points regarding the achievement test or the unit test and how to construct these tests in an appropriate manner. Thank you very much.